Dr. Haim Shapira. Dr. Haim Shapira is a senior lecturer of the Faculty of Law at the Bar-Ilan University. He received his PhD from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. His main areas of research and teaching are postdoc, rabbinic literature, jurisprudence, and modern religion. His topic is, the virtue of mercy, law, and religion. Is it correct?
Yes.
Thank you. So mercy seems to be, at least today, one of the concepts that distinguish between law and religion. In the realm of religion, mercy is a virtue. God is described as merciful and gracious, and humans who are required to imitate God must also be merciful and gracious. In the realm of law, however, mercy is not considered a virtue. The legal duty to apply the law prevents the judge from showing mercy. Even where a judge has a discretion, as in cases of determining punishment for offenders, the judge must follow certain legal considerations, such as retribution or deterrence. He is not allowed to show mercy. In this presentation, I would like to show that mercy is indeed a controversial issue, but the difference between the different approaches to mercy do not align along with the lines of law and religion. They depend on how we understand mercy and in what context one applies it. My discussion here won't be historical, textual. In other places, I dealt with some of the texts, rabbinic texts and medieval texts. Here, the discussion will be more thematic or theoretical. As many pointed out, mercy is a paradoxical concept. Most people consider mercy a virtue. On the other hand, mercy is a lenient treatment of someone compared to what he deserves. It is therefore deviation from justice. If we see justice as a value, how can we consider mercy as a virtue? And this is, I would say, a prominent approach today among lawyers and philosophers regarding mercy as presenting the problem. There are three main alternative ways to escape from this paradox. The first is to deny the moral value of mercy. If mercy is not a virtue, we are left only with justice. The second is to acknowledge the moral value of mercy, but find a certain balance between justice and mercy. The third is to show that there is no necessary contradiction between mercy and justice. I will present these three approaches and consequently revisit the relations between mercy and law and religion. In classical and modern philosophy, one can see a prominent anti-mercy tradition, which is not only opposes mercy in judgment, but also refuses to view compassion as a virtue. Remember that in Greek, there is only one term, eleos, to mercy and compassion. The same as in Hebrew, rachamim is the same, is one concept for mercy and compassion. The first objection to compassion was introduced by Socrates and Plato. They realized that the feeling of compassion reflects an appreciation of certain things as important, which their loss justifies pain or sorrow. For them, however, the source of happiness is to be found within oneself and is not dependent on external factors over which a person has no control. Feeling of compassion acknowledges the false assumption of the value of external goods and of their influence on individual happiness. Aristotle rejects this radical approach. He maintained that humans need basic existential conditions, including close people and social frameworks. Harm to these conditions or to one's intimate is liable to cause a person undeniable suffering. But still, he did not regard compassion as a virtue. Aristotle represents a second objection to compassion. His objection is based on the assumption that compassion is an emotion. Aristotle distinguished between emotions or passions and state of character. Passion is an emotional reaction caused by external reality. State of character, to the contrary, is controlled by reason and choice. Passion cannot be good or bad. State of character can be good, and thus virtue, or bad, and thus a vice. Aristotle classified compassion as a passion, and therefore it cannot be a virtue. If one turns to modern philosophy, we can mention several great names that can join this anti-compassion or anti-mercy tradition. Among them, Spinoza, Kant, Nietzsche, and others. Kant, maybe the most influential in this list, emphasized that emotions such as love and compassion should not guide the moral behavior. It is only the sense of duty originated in a rational judgment which must motivate the moral behavior and, in fact, defines it as moral action. This anti-mercy tradition can supply law with the theory that justifies the rejection of mercy. But as we immediately see, it is not necessary for law to utterly reject mercy. In contrast to this philosophical tradition, the biblical tradition views mercy as a virtue. The Hebrew Bible sees mercy as a divine attribute, a God merciful and gracious. All three monotheistic religions consider mercy a virtue and call their believers to be merciful. The question is, however, how they conceptualize mercy and how they balance it with justice. I will focus on the Jewish and rabbinic tradition. The rabbis anchor the virtue of mercy in the duty to resemble God. In Sifrei on Deuteronomy, they expounded to walk in his way, these are his way, God merciful and gracious. And similarly, in the Midrash on Exodus in Mechilta, just as he is gracious and merciful, so you also must be gracious and merciful. We must assume that the rabbis understood compassion in a different way than the philosophers. We have mentioned, they view compassion not merely as an emotional reaction, but as something that involves judgment and choice. Not only as a passive reaction to reality, but as an active attitude toward others. Attitude that expresses care, love, willing to assist others, and need and suffering. While in rabbinic literature this notion of mercy is implicit, in the writing of Maimonides, the great codifier of rabbinic law, it is explicit. Following Aristotle, Maimonides' ethics is based on virtues and implies a distinction between passion and state of character. Yet Maimonides classified mercy as a state of character and considered it as a virtue. In the Book of Commandments, he writes the following. The Torah commands us to conduct ourselves in certain qualities of character, midot, such as the command to act with kindness, mercy, pity, and love, this being contained in the verse, love your fellow as yourself. Mercy and compassion, according to Maimonides, are not only passive emotional reaction to reality, they reflect active attitude towards others. They are subject to choice, and therefore the Torah can command to embrace them. Following this line of thought, some writers have recently presented Jewish law as pro-mercy. However, along with praising mercy as a virtue, one can find in the Jewish law explicit prohibitions against mercy in judgment. Regarding penal law, the Torah declares, you must show no pity on him. And for monetary law, do not favor the poor. Following these precepts, the rabbis set a general rule, one may not show pity in judgment. Ein merachamim badin. Within Jewish tradition, we thus see a tension between mercy and justice. We can see also a path of resolving this tension through division of labor between justice and mercy. Justice must govern the judicial plane, and mercy should find its place outside the courtroom in the moral plane. Again, Maimonides represents this approach in the most consistent way. In his ethical writing, he praised mercy and encouraged action of mercy and kindness. In his legal writing, however, he was against mercy. In law concerning the Sanhedrin, he phrased the principal article that prohibits mercy in all realms of legal plane, in capital cases, penalties, monetary law as well. His consistency finds expression in the way he codified the Talmudic precedents. In the Talmud, one can find a few exceptional cases that allow a judge to show mercy. The typical case of this sort is the case of the porters in the Talmud in Baba Metzia. I don't have time to get into it, but I guess many in the room know what I'm talking about. So Maimonides did not incorporate this case in his code against other codifiers like Alfasi, like the Ashkenazi decisors. Maimonides removed this case and didn't codify it, insisting on the general rule that a judge may not show mercy in judgment. What is the justification for this distinction between the legal or judicial plane and the moral plane? Again, we can find an answer for that in Maimonides' writing. In the guide, Maimonides made a distinction between justice and righteousness, or in Hebrew, tzedek and tzedakah. He defined justice, tzedek, as granting everyone what he is entitled for. Righteousness, tzedakah, is giving someone something which he is not entitled for. An individual can claim for justice, but he has no claim for righteousness. Mercy falls under righteousness. An individual can request mercy, but he cannot claim for it. The purpose of law, according to Maimonides, is to guarantee one's right, namely guaranteeing justice. Law should not guarantee righteousness. In fact, according to this distinction, justice and righteousness contradict each other. Righteousness requires waiving one's right or doing something which is beyond duty. If a court accepts someone's request for mercy, it undermines someone else's right. The court should therefore protect rights and leave righteousness for individual choice. Rabbinic tradition represents a religious tradition that acknowledges mercy as a virtue, yet at the same time opposes to mercy in the judicial plane. The rabbis created a division of labor between mercy and justice. Justice must control the judicial process, and mercy should be a virtue in the mutual relationship or in the moral plane. The two approaches that I described so far presuppose that mercy and justice contradict each other. The third approach argues that mercy does not necessarily contradict justice. To the contrary, mercy or certain type of mercy may go along with justice and can serve as a tool to achieve justice. One of the prominent contemporary spokesmen of this approach is Martha Nussbaum. Nussbaum builds her argument on the Greek concept of epikeia, or equity. Epikeia expressed the idea that achieving justice is involved with assessing the individual case with all its particular circumstances. Aristotle used equity as a correction mechanism of law. Legal rules are general and are not always sensitive to the particular circumstances of a case. There are situations that fit the general rule, but still require exceptional treatment. The principle of equity demands from a judge to adjust the rule to the particular case. Yet, Aristotelian equity does not require a policy of mercy. It requires attention to the particular circumstances of every situation and applying the law accordingly. In some cases, it would be leniently or mercifully, but in the other cases, it would be harshly and then or stringently. Nussbaum, however, argues that a full and rich understanding of equity entails with lenient approach. She argues that the very basic of human condition pose lots of obstacles for many people. Looking into every particular case will demonstrate these difficulties and will induce the judge to be empathic and then merciful. The merciful judge will not fail to judge the guilt of the offender, but she will also see the many obstacles this offender faced as a member of culture, gender, a city or a country, and above all, as a member of the human species. Facing these obstacles, characteristics of human life in world of scarcity and accident. According to this approach, mercy is resulted from certain realistic and sincere watching of life. In order to make a correct judgment, one must take into consideration human condition in general and the unique circumstances of a case in particular. The result of this way of looking at life is necessarily compassionate and merciful. But this type of mercy does not deviate from justice. It is a tool to achieve justice. I think we may find a parallel to a certain degree in a rabbinic literature to this notion. I'm not sure I have time to analyze it fully, but just to mention. In the Tosefta, we find the following halakha. Eunuch and one who is childless are qualified for monetary cases, but disqualified for capital cases. Rabbi Yehuda adds, also the cruel and the merciful are disqualified for capital cases. The reason for the first opinion is that these two individuals, eunuch and childless, are considered merciless. Mercy is a quality that related to parental relations. An individual, maybe only men, with no children is considered merciless. They are therefore disqualified for capital cases. Rabbi Yehuda disagrees with the first anonymous opinion in two aspects. The first is that it does not refer only to these particular cases of eunuch and childless, but makes generalization, the cruel. Second, it disqualifies not only the cruel, but also the merciful. Rabbi Yehuda is clear. A judge must rule according to the law. He should not be influenced by any kind of emotion. If he is cruel, he may be too stringent. If he is merciful, he may be too lenient. Only a balanced personality who can rule according to the law and justice can be a judge in capital cases. The question is, how should we understand the first opinion, according to which a judge of capital cases must be merciful? If a judge is not allowed to show mercy, why is he required to be merciful? The answer must be that there is a difference between showing mercy and having the quality of mercy. Showing mercy is ruling in a lenient way, deviating from law. In contemporary literature, it is called sometimes true mercy. Torah law prohibits showing mercy. Having the quality of mercy refers to a disposition, a merciful attitude towards humans, including offenders. Rabbinic law prohibits showing mercy, but mandates having mercy as quality. Mercy, in this sense, is a tool and condition for achieving mercy. Let me sum up briefly. The implication of this discussion on the relation between law and religion. The different attitude toward mercy result from different psychological and normative conception of mercy. These conceptions are not divided along the lines of law and religion. Religion does not necessarily prefer mercy over justice. Jewish tradition is an example of a religious position that views mercy as a virtue but confines it to the moral plane. Jewish law opposes mercy in the judicial plane. On the other hand, mercy may be acknowledged as a virtue also from legal point of view. Even if we accept the premise that the judge must determine the just deserved punishment, and he may not show mercy, we may still see mercy in a weak sense as a tool for searching the just deserved punishment. Thank you.
Haim, I really wish you had been here yesterday when I gave a whole talk about the pardon power, but now I'll have to summarize what my point would be from that. You know, at least in later Christian traditions, starting in the Middle Ages, the pardon power is seen as a sovereign power. So the tension here is not between law and mercy so much as between law and sovereignty, where the pardon power is a manifestation of the sovereign's ability to suspend the legal order. And this is done on the analogy of divine right. Now, if that's the case, then mercy in this sense of the pardon power does seem to be, at least in this theological tradition, a religious power. The potentia Dei Absoluta was the grounding of this. And this was explicitly analogized to God's ability to interrupt the legal order through miracles and divine commands. So I want to probe a bit, first of all, to ask you if you could extend your wonderful analysis to engage with the question of sovereignty, because that's a parallel tension to the one you're, in some ways it's the same tension to the one you're describing. And secondly, I want to push back a little against your contention that it's not necessarily the case that, that religion is on the side of mercy, because at least in this other tradition, which was based upon an interpretation of the Bible, mercy was very much understood as a sovereign power that was analogous to divine grace. I hope those questions are clear.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. I am aware, to a certain extent, that Christian tradition has a different take on the relation between mercy and justice. And I allude to it when I said this, the second, what I call the second path of how we balance mercy and justice. There are different ways to balance mercy and justice. And I think one way that you mentioned within the tradition, the Christian tradition, which I don't, it's not in my expertise to deal with, but I'm aware that they have different balance between mercy and justice. And in some extent see mercy above justice. And I think this this is expressed in this power of the pardon power.
You also said early in your talk that mercy was conceived as a divine
Definitely. But I think the Jewish, at least the Rabbinic tradition, they were opposed exactly this thing. And they saw, and they want to capture mercy within the legal tradition, and therefore their balance was by basically division of labor and moving mercy outside of the court. And I didn't have the time, but there are wonderful verses and midrashic interpretation how they explain all these verses in the Bible, which says you have to be just to the poor and the widow and the orphan, and the rabbis express you have to be just to them. Don't be mercy. Don't favor them over others. So they always insist that this must define its expression within the legal system and within justice, not deviating from justice. The problem, we have to remember that many times, you know, what we call showing mercy is actually doing justice. So that's the point. So if I define mercy as deviating from justice, this is one thing. Many times we say mercy, but actually what we mean is doing justice to the weak, to the widow, to the orphan, and it's not mercy to them, it's doing justice to them. And the rabbis insist that this is the point, doing justice, not being mercy.
So what they objected to was arbitrary mercy.
Exactly.
So how do you, thank you very much, but how do you fit into this, the rabbinic projection, if you will, of midat hadin and midat harachamim onto God, and a sense that God sort of teeters, I think, between the two, and that it's the the prayers of the tzaddikim that can, of course, move God from the, you know, move the needle from one side to the other. I mean, there it seems much more kind of suspended, and if anything, with a preference for moving God from the Midat Hadin to the Midat HaRachamin, and of course, rooting it in the two divine names, which, you know, essentially says that this is of the essence of God, that he has these this sort of split,
yes,
split personality, if you will.
Exactly. And just to strengthen your question, in praying, one of the main argument in prayers, be with us merciful, and not just, not only just. Exactly. So, but I think, number one, the very conception of two different measures, measure of justice and measure of mercy, assumes that measure of justice does not include in itself mercy. So, and in early Midrashim, you find that they have even this kind of picture that God is moving from the chair of justice to the chair of mercy. So mercy and justice cannot rest on the same chair. There are different chairs. And I think my understanding of this, which is of course very important to the issue, is that they saw the relations between God and humans not only as relation between judge and people before the judge, or ruler and citizens, etc. They saw the relations also as a family relation, as a father and his children. So these two measures fit into two different metaphors of the relation between God and humanity. So one metaphor is the metaphor of ruler, king, judge, and this is the metaphor of justice. And the other metaphor is the metaphor of father, which is the family relation, and this is the metaphor that calls for mercy. So,
of course, the two are, I mean, Avinu Malkeinu, I mean,
of course, yes. But this is true only to God. But when you go to the earthly world, here you have kings and judges. You don't have fathers. So fathers you have in the family, and there you have to be merciful. But if you talk the political conception of state, of courts, of all these mechanisms, are the mundane metaphor of ruler and judge.
Please.
So,
Hanina
ben
Menachem,
he was here, now we left.
This chapter on equity, windows on Jerusalem, describes two manners of intervention, the way equity intervenes with law. And one is via legislation, and the other is what equity really was, or the Aristotelian understanding of equity, which is responding to the circumstances, coexisting with the law, measures of equity. Now, I think perhaps it's an interesting way to rephrase the distinction you made, whereas the rabbis are not willing to accept responding through measures of mercy in actual cases, they were willing to introduce it via legislation in the form of procedural law, by mandating that the judge needs to have these qualities of mercifulness. So in other words, these two different ways of intervening with the law.
Yes, but still, this quality of mercifulness is a quality that should help the judge achieving justice. He cannot arbitrarily be lenient just because his emotional reaction is towards this specific offender or this specific side in a civil case. So the point which I'm trying to make, and this is actually, I would say that if you look at scholarship, for many times it was kind of a, I would say, common wisdom that rabbinic law was against mercy in judgment. In recent years, you find new tendency trying to show that there is some, you know, willingness to accept mercy in judgment in rabbinic tradition. So I'm trying to go back to this assumption and trying to make a new to suggest a new account how they dealt with these two values of virtues.
We have time for only one last question, please. Okay. I'm just going to add to what the judge said. So as much as there is this rhetoric which is against mercy, the law itself
the rabbis made it almost impossible to actually convict a person of murder. And in most of the punishments, it's very, very hard to actually carry it out. And a verse which is often in a boat is one of the Silu Ha'idat, and the congregation shall save. So I don't know if it's a mercy underlying that, but it's almost, I don't know if you ever...
Okay, thank you for the question. I think it is very important to make this distinction between, number one, legislation and adjudication. Number two, between policy and mercy or ideology. The rabbis were against capital punishment. This is quite clear. And this was, it is not out of mercy. This is the way they understood the proper punishment. They were against, and there are different views, you know why, maybe because the creation in the human, in the image of God, maybe because they were humane, many different, you know, suggestions. But it is clear that their policy or their ideology regarding punishment was against capital punishment. It's not, it is not a matter of mercy. This is the proper law.
It's the proper punishment.
No, maybe of corporal punishment. Corporal punishment, not just capital punishment, also corporal punishment.
Some vindication.
You know, maybe different things. What I'm trying to say that
it's a policy,
it's a policy or ideology how to create, to make the law. This is the matter of legislation. When we are talking about mercy, we are talking of something that in a specific case, the judge, not the legislature, the judge act out of mercy. So, this
but that goes against the biblical law, which is very powerful.
Okay, so this is, you know, this the whole question of rabbinic power to interpret the law.
Okay, I think it's now time enough for lunch.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much.